to come into a new group of meditators I haven't sat with before. It seems like many people come here fairly frequently to these Saturday gatherings. That's wonderful. In the chant that we did just before our sitting, there's a line which is, seeing venerated seekers of the truth, this is the highest blessing. And that's interesting to reflect on. On one level, it can just mean Kalyanamitta, which is a Pali term, which just means spiritual friends or good friends along the path. And so that's all of you. We all kind of support one another. It's easier for most people to practice in a group than to do this whole spiritual thing by themselves, just alone in a room. So it's great to come together and see other spiritual seekers of the truth. On another level, the Pali for that line is seeing samanas. So a samana is specifically talking about on one level, it's, you know, a spiritual seeker who's ordained, but even on a higher level, it's someone who's actually enlightened. So the true samanas are people who are actually enlightened, and those can be monks, or they can be nuns, or they can be non-monks or non-nuns, just normal people who are not wearing these robes. But yeah, this is an aspect of Buddhism which sometimes people are surprised about. The whole of Buddhism is not just one thing. It's not just one technique. It's not just looking at the breath. The Buddhist canon is big. The Buddha taught a lot and taught many different types of people and taught in many diverse environments. And it's not just meditate, meditate, meditate. There's so many other psychological supports running from spiritual friendship to ways that we speak with one another, who we choose to hang out with, the different ways that we direct the mind, the different ways that we meditate. And one big aspect of the Buddhist path in every tradition is what's called right view, samadhiti, or maybe a better translation could be a view which is in tune, or a view which is harmonious with the way things are. So in the earliest scriptures, there's different things which the Buddha specifically labeled as being right view. And one of those is the belief that there are samanas, so there are people, there are spiritual seekers of the truth who have realized for themselves in this very lifetime, quote, this world and the other world. And they teach that to other people. So that's a bit of jargon, and how it's usually understood is there are people who have realized nibbana, who've realized nirvana. And this is, that's a belief, you know, does one believe that or not, that it is possible to attain enlightenment? And what does that even mean? In our tradition of Buddhism, actually all traditions of Buddhism, enlightenment is a very explicit and specific mind state. And it's a mind state which is absolutely free from three things, just three. Greed, anger, and delusion. That's all you gotta do, just get rid of those three. And, yeah, maybe a tall order, but to some degree, I mean, especially those first two, you know, greed and anger, you can feel that. And the more you stay on this path and start noticing the subtle manifestations and not so subtle manifestations and gross and mean manifestations of greed and anger, then the more clear your conception of what the goal might be like. But it is an article of belief to say, oh yeah, I believe that it is possible to totally, that it is possible for a human being, not just a Buddha, not just some monk somewhere, but it is possible to fully cleanse the heart of greed, anger, and delusion. And that's such an important belief that the Buddha highlighted it as being a almost a tenet of right view. And it's something that you can, to some degree, we can choose what we believe, to some extent. But again, belief or even faith kind of operate on many different levels. So, we want to be seeing things accurately. And fortunately, the Buddha said that not only is it a helpful belief to believe that it is possible to attain enlightenment, it is possible to get rid of these things which kind of taint the heart. But it's true. This is a state which is possible. And do we believe the Buddha or not? And it can help when you've actually met people who you believe have attained this state. And this is maybe not something which is very common. You know, you're not finding arhats, or that's someone who's fully enlightened. They're maybe not on every corner, but you can, when you enter into certain circles, so for Thon Nisabo and myself, we've been living in monasteries for 10 years, meeting and living with teachers who've been practicing on the path for decades, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, basically devoting all of their waking life to meditation, to harmlessness, to speaking kindly, to all the factors of the Eightfold Path. And we live very close with some of these teachers. I mean, seeing them in many different environments, and you get to know somebody when you're living very close with them. And you can't, for most of us, we can't really know like where somebody's mind is. You know, I can't prove that any particular teacher that I've had or someone I've lived with, you know, that their mind is totally free from different mental obstructions. But you can make inferences. You can see, I saw this teacher, this friend, in this particular environment, which is very trying, and there is absolutely, it seemed, apparently no greed or no anger in an environment which would, seems like it would elicit greed and anger on a very, in a very blunt way. And then we have other teachers who we respect, and then they respect other teachers, and it becomes a matter of faith, and then you go and meet someone like this, and I know from my own experience and in the experience of many of my friends, and again, this is where things might get a little bit spooky for some people, but you get within some kind of parameter, so you get within 10 feet of a being who you believe to be enlightened, and it does something to your mind. And this could be, you know, some kind of expectation bias, or all sorts of inner biases. Could be a total placebo effect, but it's kind of undeniable when you feel this internally. And that's not necessarily proof that someone's enlightened, but it is interesting to note, and that can kind of increase one's faith in, there's something special about this being. So, just something for people to experiment with, a thought experiment. What do I think about that? Do I think that it's actually possible to cleanse the mind from greed totally, to be totally without greed? And some voice might start yelling, I don't want to be free from greed. I love my greed. And yeah, there are types of desire which are part of the path, like desiring to practice, desiring to live with and have good friends. That's a wholesome desire, which is part of the path. But the greed, the kind of clingy attachment, is something which it just sucks. And it's not that hard to feel that it just drains your energy, and it's not beautiful when you see it in yourself, and it's not beautiful when you see it in other people. And similar with anger, you know, you say, is it possible to totally cleanse the heart of anger? And if you don't specifically ask this question, chances are you're operating from a default view of either yes, it is, if you've grown up maybe in a Buddhist culture where that's just the norm. I mean, you don't even question it. Yeah, of course there are enlightened beings. Of course, you know, the Buddhist path is real. Or if you grow up in a non-Buddhist culture, like probably most people in this room, it's your unquestioned assumption that I've never asked myself this before, or yeah, of course it's not possible, and it's not even desirable. I mean, what about righteous indignation? Aren't there things which like are worthy of being angry about? And it's a good question to ask. There are certainly, yeah, injustice is something which we can work towards and should work towards fixing in our various ways in the world. But being angry about it doesn't necessarily help. I mean, it can give you energy, and that's not hard to see. I mean, when you're angry about something which you feel you're right about, or you are right about it, your anger can give you some sense of energy, and you can like defeat the other person, and that feels good. But over the long stretch, it's not really sustainable. I mean, you start when you're annoying everybody around you, or worse, the people you care about most, which is often what we do. You know, we're spraying out our greed all over the people who we care about most, and it doesn't feel good when other people do it to us, and it probably doesn't feel good when we do it to other people. So maybe that would be a good idea, to keep working towards getting rid of anger in my heart. And whether or not that's totally possible, you might come to the conclusion, maybe I'll hold that if I want to as a working hypothesis. And fair enough. I mean, what else can you do? But yeah, if you can, yeah, maybe it is worth actively trying to cultivate this perception. It certainly, in my mind, doesn't help to cultivate the opposite. So for me to act, now that the question has been raised, whether or not people have ever conceived of this as an important question before, the question's been raised, so now you kind of have to take a position on it. Like, is it possible? Is it not possible? Is it both? Is it neither? Do I not really care? At some level, you kind of have to take a position, and if you take the position, no, it's not possible, then that could be self-defeating. But if you take it as, yeah, it could be possible, and that's what you bow to. I mean, when we bow, it's a matter of bowing towards our own highest aspiration, our own, it's not just that it is possible for someone else to cleanse the heart, purify the heart, make the heart nicer, learn how to purify our awareness. It's not just that other people somewhere else can do that, but yeah, I believe that I could do that. And that's what we're bowing towards. When we bow to a shrine, when we bow to anything, hopefully that's what we can keep in mind. This thing that I'm bowing to, if it's the shrine, this is a symbol of my own aspirations. And yeah, you can remember that I mean, for people in monasteries, monks and nuns, we train, first thing we wake up in the morning, first thing we do is bow. Every hut in every monastery I know, well, most monasteries, all the huts have their own shrine with a statue or a picture of the Buddha or great teachers who one respects. Some other very minimal monasteries only have one huge Buddha statue in the whole monastery. And when you first wake up, then you just like figure out which direction that main building is in, and you kind of bow towards that direction. But that's how we start our day. And this is beautiful. This is, you know, you're orienting yourself in a very clear direction. I'm orienting myself towards something which I believe is possible to achieve. And you can do this at the end of the day. That's what we do in monasteries, is end of the day, before I go to bed, is just bowing towards one shrine. And just remembering, okay, this is a nice way to start the evening, nice way to go to bed, just bow to my shrine. And if you don't like bowing, that's totally okay. There's no compulsion to bow. So I've mentioned that Tan Nisibo and I have both, it's our faith. This is an article of belief. We can't prove it, but have lived with and spoken with and asked questions of and had back and forth conversations with people who we believe have purified the heart to some degree or another, possibly even up to the stage of arhatship, someone who's fully enlightened. In fact, even somewhat recently, we had a conversation with a teacher who we both believe is enlightened. And yeah, we can't prove it, but I certainly can't point to anything where I've like seen unwholesome mind states pop up in that person, and they've never done anything which is like abused my own this confidence or this belief. They've never tried to take anyone else's belief in their possible enlightenment for any kind of ego gain or ego game. But yeah, in this conversation that Tan Nisibo and I had, having this person who we both highly respect, they said something which I found. They said a couple things which are worthy to reflect on. So you can imagine if someone doesn't have any greed, anger, and delusion, or you know, to some extent they have attenuated those things in their heart, they're going to see the world in a very different way than the rest of us who are just kind of like wallowing in our own, you know, stewing in our own greed and anger and delusion. So this particular monk lives in Thailand and was reflecting. We were talking about our experience in America, and this monk was kind of reflecting on different American, almost American mantras. So the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So this particular monk kind of highlighted that, the pursuit of happiness, the pursuit of happiness, pursuing happiness, pursuing happiness. Like that is, and on one level, everybody in the world, all humans, probably all beings, all animals are, you know, trying to increase pleasure and decrease displeasure, decrease pain. But there's a unique kind of American flavor to this pursuit of happiness, which is, for most people don't know the peace that can come from just a quiet mind. Most people have not experienced the peace which hopefully people in this room have experienced this morning. I mean, just being able to stop, the peace of not having to chase after something and not being able to just settle into the present moment. And this monk was saying, pursuit of happiness, yeah, that's like an American mantra, pursuing happiness. But he said, happiness is not to be pursued, happiness is to be realized. And I found that fascinating, because it takes the whole spiritual pursuit into the present moment. So on one level, we have this this belief, okay, there is an end game. There is a, fully freeing the heart from greed, anger, and delusion. But I can do my part in this present moment to not, you know, to notice different afflictive and wholesome mind states that are manifesting in the present moment. And I can realize happiness, some degree of happiness, like right now, just with a shift of attention. It's maybe not the best metaphor, because shifting into neutral in your car isn't necessarily inherently happiness producing, but that is I think that is a good metaphor for the way that you can learn to shift your attention. And this can take practice, but the more, when we were meditating, we talked about meditation being the art of choice. It's meditation is learning how to choose in the present moment, and we can choose to shift out of other mind states which we're not finding helpful, and just have a level of knowing, of awareness, which is not mixed up with those things. So not mixed up with all the ego or the jealousy or the envy or the fear or the anxiety and the anger and the hatred and the craving and the delusion. it's almost like there's a word, autoscopy, which is a fancy name for seeing yourself. And this can be used to refer to, you know, some people, especially on their deathbed, will have out-of-body experiences where they can almost see. It's like literally, it seems like their consciousness is floating above their body and they can see their body. And to some extent, this is, you don't have to get that far out of your body to be able to shift into this mode. It's a it's a autoscopy. It's a seeing of yourself even while you're embodied, even while the mind and consciousness are still fully inhabiting the whole body. And that's fascinating to experiment with. So, yeah, happiness is not to be pursued, it's to be realized. And this particular teacher did not, he wasn't using the word realized when he said that to mean as your final goal. Like, he wasn't saying happiness is not to be pursued, it's to be realized in the future, but he was meaning it as happiness is to be realized, like right here, when we establish contentment in the heart. In one particular discourse in the Dhammapada, which is a nice little compendium of short little Buddhist Dhamma poems, the Buddha says contentment is the highest wealth, and Nibbana is the highest happiness. And this particular teacher also talked about the knowing element, which is basically the capacity for awareness, capacity to just appreciate what we're experiencing in the body and in the mind in the present moment. And that, as we purify it over time, so that will lead to the Nibbana element. That will lead to Nibbana as we purify our capacity for awareness. So it's, in some other Buddhist traditions, they have a phrase which is taking the goal as the path. So the goal is Nibbana, which is a state free from greed, anger, and delusion. And we can take some degree of that as our path, like as much as possible. I can operate in the world anytime that I'm talking with someone, anytime I'm listening to someone, whatever I'm doing, walking, sitting, standing, lying down, I can bring some degree of knowledge and awareness and disengaging from unwholesome mental states. People might not be ready to fully take on that belief of there are beings in the world who have realized Nibbana and teach it. If you're not to that phase yet, or you don't believe that that is a possible goal, then that's totally fine. Again, on one level, you can't, as I mentioned, you can't fully tweak, you can't fully shift your deep-seated beliefs, you know, just with the turn of a dial. But yeah, some, we have a lot of unexamined assumptions which are very deep in our heart, and if they're unhelpful, if they're not really helping us, then you can want to believe something different. And again, in a Buddhist context, we want to believe true things. Yeah, the Buddha's path is a path of truth. We're trying to see things more and more accurately. But until we realize this state for ourselves, we can't really know it. You kind of have to speculate on these things, because it might be a while before we fully realize the deepest, you know, full enlightenment. But yeah, this is something I want to believe. You know, I want to believe that it is possible, and I don't find that to be a harmful belief for sure, and honestly find it to be extremely life supportive. It supports everything. I mean, New Year's is coming up, the end of the year is coming up. I mean, I personally do find it helpful to reflect on, you know, what kind of, how was this past year? How do I want the next year to go? And to consciously take the time to, establish New Year's resolutions, or at least inclinations. And this belief in enlightenment, really, and that it's something that we can do, is an extremely guiding and overarching umbrella belief which can inform all of our other immediate aspirations and practices. When I haven't fully decided what all I want for my New Year's aspirations to be, but when I do decide that, all of them will be within this this frame of working towards enlightenment. And that's not just a personal pursuit. This is going to involve all of our relationships with other people. I want to maximize and give importance to and respect and be grateful for and deeply grateful for and remember that I'm grateful for all of the connections and friendships and dhammic inspirations that I have in my life. And so this is just one way you can frame your whole life, and why not? I don't see a drawback. But again, you can't just force yourself to believe things. So if you want to believe it, then keep trying to believe it. And one way, you know, which kind of takes Buddhism, takes anything religious out of the picture, one very straightforward formulation of this concept that is, it is possible to abandon unwholesome mind states, and it is possible to cultivate wholesome mind states. Just that. And that can guide every decision we make in every direction that we guide our minds. So it's 11:30, and maybe shift into a Q&A mode. And thanks everybody for people's patience. And yeah, we can, maybe for Tan Nisibo and myself, if people had a general question, or for either one of us. Yeah, please.
Oh. Just quickly, in our tradition, sometimes when there's two monks, we get to do a brief sadhu for their talk. So I will say something, and then we all sadhu two times. Andamayamu vadadamakatayo sadhu karangadamase sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Uh-huh. think about turning down anger, maybe it becomes something more like resentment. So, I mean, I see similarities, but I see them as being somewhat distinct. And I'm wondering if you can speak to why you use the term that you do and what you might know of other teachers who would say greed, hatred, and pollution.
Right. Repeat the question. Yeah, that was a great question. So, talking about, I use the term greed. Did I say greed, hatred?
Anger.
I said anger, okay, that's what I usually say. So I said greed, anger, and delusions as these three root unwholesome mind states. And there's a question about other teachers might say greed, hatred, and delusion. And what are the distinctions between these and other types of aversive mind states, such as resentment and.
Well, I guess, so a way that that thinking of hatred has been helpful to me is thinking, like, if you were to dial down the intensity of hatred, it becomes dislike. And, like, I think if you were to dial that, and so I can recognize dislike in myself, like, very often. whereas hatred, that's pretty extreme.
Right.
I might not hate very often. So if I think of using anger in the same kind of way, okay, if I were to dial down anger, what might that look like? Well, maybe that would feel like resentment. I could recognize resentment in myself.
Readily. Bringing up a really good point of, hatred is a pretty strong word, so something which is more relatable on a regular basis maybe for some people might be dislike. And it's a very good point. So the Buddha talked, the Buddha really spoke to the person who he was speaking to. Like, and sometimes the Buddha would just talk about there's only one defilement, and that's delusion. There's only one unwholesome mind state, and that's delusion. Or there's three, which are often termed as the root, the mula, unwholesome mind states. This raga, dosa, and moha is the Pali, and similar in Sanskrit. Or you would talk about the five hindrances, which are sensual desire, ill will, restlessness, and worry, sloth and torpor, and doubt. Or he would talk about the 16 defilements, which are actually many states that you talked about, like dislike and aversion and hatred. And there are specific words which he used for these things. And with the three root unwholesome mind states, I think those are meant also as catch-all terms. So for the full aversive spectrum. So I think aversion might be the best word here to catch everything in that spectrum, because it really does go all the way to cruelty, even on the one extreme of this of that scale. But then it's also just the slight annoyances, like when you notice that I've been like furrowing my brow because of some bodily tension that I have, and just the aversion that I have towards that tension is a form of dosha or devesha. And it's interesting to note that these are not specifically Buddhist concepts. You know, in the Bhagavad Gita, a Hindu text, they're using pretty much the exact same terms for those first two, greed and anger. And similarly, with the greed spectrum, that's everything in the liking arena. So even when you notice your mind slightly, tilting towards some pleasant experience, or slightly inclining towards trying to get that thing which is nice, that's what that greed arena is speaking to. And delusion is just catch-all. I mean, we're both, greed and anger are subsets of delusion. But I really do find it helpful to be as specific and to be able to name my mind states as clearly as possible. It's just fun, honestly. I mean, and the more you can notice and get familiar with the ones, because it's not like you kind of see the same ones hatching up again and again, and you get to know their patterns, and then you can figure out specific antidotes. So it's a really good question. Yeah, thank you.
Can I say something else?
Yeah.
In Thailand, we don't see this. In the teaching, the Ajahn, the teacher, you say, thank you quite a lot.
One famous teacher says that greed and hatred are the two arms of delusion. So it doesn't, you know, like Ajahn Kovilo says, there's a lot to be gained from those exact colorations of each, but the essential motion is the pushing or the pulling, and whether we're holding something at arm's length or holding it to our chest, either way, it's holding. And there's a famous story of a monk asking Ajahn Chah, he says, I can feel greed and hatred, but I can't feel delusion or see delusion. And Ajahn Chah said, you're riding a horse and asking where the horse is, which the monk mistranslated as, well, I'm not going to say what he mistranslated it as, but it's somewhat appropriate, but also worked slightly. Ajahn Sumedho finds it useful to name his mind states as different breeds of dog. So we all have like the frightened Chihuahua in the corner, or the Rottweiler, or the Labrador, so that can help too. It doesn't just have to be
That's
names.
Good. That's good. That's good. Daniel?
Hi. I have been pondering the difference between wholesome desire and unwholesome desire, and Chanda and Tanha. And I'm wondering if wholesome desire can be painful, or if pain means it automatically is an unwholesome desire.
So the question is about wholesome and unwholesome desire in Buddhist teachings, and remarked that there's two different Pali words. So you have chanda, which is the wholesome desire, which is part of the Eightfold Path that comes up in right effort. So you want to generate desire to arouse unarisen wholesome mind states. You want to generate desire to increase and develop wholesome mind states that have already arisen. You want to generate desire to get rid of unwholesome mind states that have arisen, and generate desire not to have, you know, other bad states that you haven't, like, aren't experiencing, have those not arise. So that's a generating desire, that's chanda. But then you have tanha, which is the second noble truth, which is the cause of suffering. And so, yeah, being as explicit as possible. And the question was, can you differentiate those by the hedonic tone or the feeling, is that right? Like of pleasure? Like if, was that the question?
Whether or not a wholesome desire can be painful.
Can be painful, okay.
Pain automatically means that it is unwholesome.
Pain? No, there are times, like if people have exercised, you know, when you're actually, the body's in physical pain, but you are, it's not necessarily unwholesome. Mm. You know, you can engage the mind, and oftentimes it's when you really are kind of pushing yourself, not necessarily going to a state of pain, but seeing what you can, seeing what the mind can put up with, you know, like sitting maybe for a little bit longer than you're used to, and just because the body might have some degree of physical pain, that doesn't mean that you're cultivating desire, you know, unwholesome desire. It can actually be part of the path. And again, it's, you have physical pain and you've got mental pain, and they're largely separate. So like an arhat, someone who's enlightened, has no mental suffering. They have no mental suffering, but they still experience physical suffering. I mean, if they're, you know, work out, or, you know, or they're going to sit for 3 hours, their body is going to, you know, experience physical unpleasantness as human bodies do, but they just don't, the mind doesn't suffer with it. There's no mental pain. So, it's a good question about this relationship between desire and pain. You can, if you are actively and consciously aware that you're exercising desire in a wholesome way, then that in itself can be a cause for non-pain, can be a cause for delight even to manifest in the mind. So as you're exercising, you're pushing yourself, you've done that, you know, 60th push-up, the body is doing one thing, but when you realize, oh, actually, I'm doing something that I want to do, and it's helping the body, and I'm in a good mind state, then great. That can actually, like, in the moment, you can realize happiness, like, in the moment when you have this shift of perception. So, do you want to add anything?
And the Buddha also spoke about two sorts of, he talked about worldly and otherworldly pain and pleasure, and worldly pain is, you know, not attaining, you know, sensual pleasures which one wants and other forms of suffering, but otherworldly negative, like otherworldly or spiritual pain is desire to attain one's spiritual goals and wholesome regret. Both of those are considered factors of the path.
About how to distinguish between a desire-free state, which and depression. So you have like a state in, I speak of psychiatrists and psychologists, anhedonia, which is basically not being able to experience pleasure or not actually being motivated to have different desires. And one thing which can really help with that, because it's in a depressive state, you're either treading water or you've actually like submerged to some extent and you're not really seeing clearly yourself, so it can be hard to see these things clearly within yourself. But friends are a really great thing. I mean, when you and again, it's hard to friendship is something which can be hard to maintain and remember how useful it is when one's feeling depressed. But friends really do they can be a mirror for ourselves in a way which we can't when we are, yeah, drowning in a sense. So yeah, remembering friendships, and this is true outside of the monastery, true in the monastery, and I think a lot of people decide to go to the monastery, maybe because they're depressed to some degree, and they don't yet really have a positive. They're running away from something rather than being excited to go to the monastery for, you know, to chase towards something else. They just want to get away from suffering outside. And being a monk in our tradition really does involve like learning how to live with a community. And that's really helpful. There are ways of being a monk. And in Thailand, it's easy to get ordination. I mean, you can just like go to a monastery and for a donation or something, you might be able to get ordained that weekend, maybe. And then just go off to a cave or go off to some place where you're just all by yourself. And I think it's almost like a trope in a monastery that most people are not ready to go and practice by themselves in such a way. Your highs might be higher because you're able to focus on a meditation object, but your lows can be a lot lower. And when you're in a community, kind of maybe the highs are slightly less high because you got to go to, morning meditation, I got to go to the work period or whatever, but the lows are also less low because you got your friends kind of helping you not drown. So, do you have any thoughts on that? They're also in desirelessness. I mean, desirelessness is one, sometimes even like a synonym for nibbana or for like a heightened state on the path, but it doesn't come alone. You know, as one like progresses on the path, it comes with other factors, and some of those are delight and joy. And if you're not experiencing those like positive affect emotions, like joy, then it might be helpful to try to seek those out in a different way, to even if the desireless is genuine and it is like based on a genuine insight into impermanence and the fragility of life and all these other things. You really do want to balance yourself with, all of us, we want to balance ourselves with finding ways to bring joy into the heart. And there's lots of those in a Buddhist context as well. So.
We might have time for one more question, and maybe there's one on the live stream as well. If others have questions, though, it's fine too.
Right, right. I don't. It's a good question about on New Year's Day. So next week we won't have the meditation here. It'll be Christmas. Then the following week is another Saturday, so January 1st. And Tanisbo hadn't, and I hadn't, I'll be here, I'll still be here. And we hadn't yet talked about the specifics of, hadn't talked about the specifics of what we'd be talking about, but I'd love to, yeah, talk about that and reflect on that. You do it together as a group. Is it possible for wholesome attachments to become hindrances on the path, or to, both for oneself, or if one is attached or cares about one's friends or family? And at the end, so Nibbana is a state of non-attachment, complete non-attachment, and why that is the case is because Nibbana is the highest happiness, and happiness is basically a state. The highest happiness is a state of having absolute, no clinging, no clinging attachments. But for the path, there are states which are good to hold on to. So like when taking the precepts, if you do it in Pali, you use the word samadana, which literally means I undertake the precepts. But a related word is upadana, which is attachment. So we're holding on, and the Buddha recommended that, and holding on to our precepts, holding on to our practice of being generous people. And to some extent, maybe like our friendships, but it becomes difficult. Within ourselves, it's easy to, well, not easy, but you can see it more clearly when you start to latch on, clinch on to different mind states. And with our relationships with other people, that's just so much more out of our control. Like, I'm the owner of my own karma. I'm the heir of my own karma. Whatever I do for good or for ill, that I'll be the heir. And other people, it's the same. And we can't really control other people. I mean, we can kind of control ourselves sometimes, to some degree. But like other people, it's like a totally different realm. So yes, attachments get tricky with regards to other people. So figuring out how you can hold on to the relationships which are really most important, but not clenching in a way which harms yourself and harms others.